that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in.
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, with no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, a 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath. The planets form. If the stars were made to worship so loud, I can see your heart. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises so loud.
Good evening. I'm so glad that everybody made it out this evening. Amen. My name is Pastor Eric Salas. I had the pleasure of actually being Matt's pastor when he was here in California before he headed out to Oklahoma and he left us all high and dry. But you know, he discovered and he found something in Oklahoma, another church, another place, but ultimately that was the place that the Lord decided would be the home, the place that he would use to take him home. And all of us here, though, in California, all of the lives that have been touched, every single one of you are here because you've been touched by Matt in one way or the other. And all of us here this evening are worshipers. We love the Lord, and we wanted to do something that would really truly reflect the spirit that Matt had. I mean, we understand that memorial services can be sad. We understand that actually for all of us left on this side is where all the pain is. Matt's having a great time right now. He's loving it up there in heaven. But ultimately what we wanted to do today to really truly honor him and memorialize him is we were able to gather the worship team from the old church that he was a part of, and we're going to be able to play some of Matt's favorite songs and see some great memories of Matt. So let me pray as we open this. Father, we give you the glory and the honor and the praise, and thank you for gathering everybody here to this house. Gathering us here, Lord God, that we would memorialize, Lord God, Matt Rotherham. Lord, he was a man that touched so many hearts and did so much work for your kingdom. So Lord, we would just pray that during this evening, you would just, your will would be done, your perfect will would be done, that you would touch the hearts, console the hearts of those that are weeping and mourning. And let us remember Matt for who he really was, Lord God, that worshiper, Lord, the one who would invite all of us and provoke all of us into a state of worship. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
You guys might be wondering why this guitar is right here. And right before he left to Oklahoma, it was about in 2019, and I just picked up the guitar. And it was his last service, and it was the last everything, the last time I basically saw him in Oklahoma. And he goes, "Hey, you gonna practice?" And obviously I knew, because I was already playing drums and I wasn't playing piano yet. And he goes, "You gonna practice?" And he was loud. So we're across the parking lot and he says, "You gonna practice?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm gonna practice, why?" And he gets out of his car, and if you know anything about Taylor, they're very expensive guitars. And it's very beautiful. He had awesome taste. And he opens the trunk of his car and he pulls out this guitar and he goes, "Here you go." And I go, "What?" And knowing everything, knowing that the stories behind this guitar, how he was playing with the pick and his pick fell and he started strumming so hard that he started bleeding because he was strumming so hard from his fingers and he started bleeding. I go, "No, it's fine. I'm fine." He goes, "No, man, here, you need to start practicing because you're gonna play for the Lord." And I go, "Okay, Matt." And I know where he's at, but it's still on this side of heaven. It's really rough. But the reason why we have this guitar is for remembrance of Matt and who he was. He was a worshiper of the Lord. He wasn't your bystander who would sit in the pew, but instead he was a worshiper of the Lord. So as we sing with the voice of triumph, I encourage you guys to sing with us. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Like my husband says, it's a little medley of the songs that we did over and over at Norwalk. And these were like Matt's in his pocket songs. So every time we would do a song, he'd throw a song in there. And we would look at him and he would say, "We already did that one, Matt." He's like, no, we can mix it up. So we're going to ask if you feel free, if you feel comfortable enough to stand. We're here to worship the Lord. Because of the time that he gave us with Matt, and we're so grateful. So if you would join us in worshiping just for a few minutes, just thanking God for the impact that he made in our lives. Yes.
Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame, and the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out. Lord, my soul cries out, everlasting, your light will shine when else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame, and the cry of my heart is to bring you praise
bow down in your presence at your throne.
Let's sing that again. My whole life.
My whole life I place in your hands, God of mercy.
unto God with a voice of triumph. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Shout unto God with a voice of praise. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Voice of praise. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. Shout out to God with a voice of praise. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Shout out to God with a voice of triumph. Shout out to God with a voice of praise. Shout out to God with the voice of triumph. We lift your name up. We lift your name up. Thank you.
this wonderful evening that you've given us. And Lord, we ask that your presence that's already been established in this place, Lord God, would just go in and out of the aisles, again, comforting the hearts of those that have come, but knowing, Lord God, that Matt smiles down on us right now. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys may be seated. Amen. Many of you were able to pick up one of the programs when you came in, just to kind of let you know what the order of service is going to be. And at this time, I would like to invite up Nicholas Rotherham, who is Matt's brother. He's going to give the eulogy. Come on up, Nick.
Good evening. As you heard, my name is Nick Rotherham. I'm Matt's younger brother. We were 13 months apart, so I guess you could imagine how hectic that might have been for our parents growing up. My brother Matt was born in Los Alamitos, California, and he lived in La Palma for the first 30 years of his life. He's survived by his parents, Kathy, John, his brothers, myself, and Bobby, his wife, Aunt Lana, their three children, Uncle Bobby, his three children, Silas, Elijah, and Ellison. Matthew married Aunt Lana on March 26, 2017, and they moved from California to Tulsa, Oklahoma, in March of 2019, and this is where their family is now. Matthew loved sports. In his younger days, he was a Cleveland Indians fan, but he eventually would come around to see the Dodgers were the team to root for. He played soccer, baseball, basketball, and hockey. Matthew loved to camp and fish and looked forward to taking his family to his favorite fishing spot in Rock Creek. When we were younger, we went on a short vacation to San Francisco, and we were told to make sure to go out to breakfast at a small restaurant called Sears. Matthew ordered his usual breakfast, pancakes, eggs, and bacon. When his food came, he just picked at it and asked if he can have a to-go box. This, as many of you may know, was very unusual for Matthew. But when we left the restaurant, he gave his food to a homeless man that he had seen on our way in. And that, as many of you may know, is very like Matthew. At 12 years old, his mom encouraged him to learn to play guitar. He didn't have much interest in the guitar, but our mom was very persistent, as many of you also may know. She hired a teacher for him, and he became an accomplished guitar player. His first public performance was on a ministry trip in Mexico. We were in junior high, I would say. He led worship for the children at the orphanage. This changed his life. In his early adult life, he led worship at Praise Chapel in Stanton and Norwalk, and then for Youth Guts Ministry in Oklahoma. Atlanta met Matthew at a Valentine's Day party in Whittier, California in 2016. She wasn't looking for a relationship and honestly thought he had come with somebody else and didn't pay any attention to him. I think we may have different opinions of what happened. During the party, there were some children playing a Wii game, Just Dance. Atlanta jumped right in and started winning all the games. Matthew then decided that he wanted to challenge her. As they played the game, Matthew was dancing all wild and not making any points, allowing Atlanta to win. The night was ending, but before it did, Atlanta heard Matthew and his friends talking about youth ministry. She said, "Hey, that's what I want to do." Matthew then invited her to their youth beach day the next day. She ignored him there all day. She thought he wasn't prepared, but admired his commitment to the kids. As he drove the kids back home, Matthew began to talk about what he wanted in the future. Atlanta didn't say anything but thought, "Wow, that's exactly what I want to do as well." They left each other that night with a handshake initiated by Matt, which Atlanta thought was very weird. But he texted her later that night saying thank you, and then they never stopped talking after that. The last 6 years together were the best years anyone could ask for. Matthew provided everything for his family and loved them with everything in him. As Matthew and Atlanta built their family in Tulsa, it was centered around faith. As they spoke about their goals and struggles, Matthew echoed the family motto, "I believe." Matthew always trusted in the Lord. Thank you.
We have, and I know we're going to open up the mic a little bit later on for friends and family that would like to come and say a few words. We have some very special tributes for Matt. We have Danny Howland, Brian Campos, and again, Nick Rotherham. So if you guys can, Danny, why don't you go ahead and come on forward. Brian, as soon as he's completed, just go ahead and come up. And same thing with Nick as soon as you're done. So that way we can kind of keep this thing going, all right? So Danny Howland. Oh, there you are. All right.
Good evening, everyone. Okay. My name's Danny. I had the privilege of knowing Matt since I think he was about 7 years old. I used to work at a school, and I remember the first time he and his brother Nick showed up. I can't remember if it was like a spring break week. It was something where they just came for daycare, and Matt was just this above size for his age, you know, tall for his age, skinny, real quiet, but really good at sports. And then his brother was like the complete opposite, wild, crazy, total energetic. And I was just like, who are these two kids? And the thing is, when you're with kids, you don't choose them. Like, as much as you could say, hey, this is a great kid, Rick, they choose you. And having them part of my life was definitely life-changing. This is going to be tough, so I'll try to get through this. I got to know Nick and Matt, and then their parents, Kathy and John. They took me in, and I was basically family. I was big brother to them. I watched them. I spent so much time with them. We did so many things. First Harlem Globetrotters game together. Went to hockey games together. And when I ended up leaving the school and ended up getting married to another worker who worked there, they came to our house every week. And the thing that I always loved about Matt from the day I met him to, I mean, he was always the same. He was, you know, he was very quick wit. He was very observant at everything that was happening. He always made me laugh with his comments. I was like, he was, you know, 10 years old, and I felt like he could be hanging out with me and all my older 20-year-old buddies. Yeah, he was hilarious, and he never changed. He was always the same way, but through the year, oh, yeah, one story I wanted to share. One thing that I was talking about with, like, I got to remember sometimes. As they were getting older and we were teenagers, we still hung out. You know, we did countless hours, hundreds and hundreds of hours of Super Smash Brothers to Capture the Flag to football. Oh, my gosh, we got in football so many times. And Matt, I remember one time they were teenagers and, you know, you used to take it easy on them. And I remember we were playing on one of those small courts, and Matt comes up and just jams on my head. He dunks, and he had never done that. And I'm like, whoa, okay, you want to play like that? All right, let's play. We're going to play prison rules. And I'm like, you know, and they're just kind of looking at me, and I'm like, yeah, yeah. And so I'm trying to get aggressive, and I go to dunk. And I can't remember if Matt blocked me or something. I didn't score. And then Matt just, like, looks at me, and he's like, Danny? And he's all straight-faced like he always said. He's all, what's prison rules? You know, it was just that's just how he was, and how Nick said with the guitar, you know, I tried to learn to play the guitar, and he would bring it over on Fridays or Saturdays, and he would just, you know, play it so naturally, and I would struggle, and he'd always be like, no, just stick with it, keep going, and I didn't stick with it. My daughter ended up breaking the strings, so I never ended up restringing it. I was lazy, but with everything he ever did, Matt was always hilarious. I'm going to share, I'll say a few things, yeah. He pushed with everything we did. Oh, yeah, two things. We have a big group in that we got very close with. Brian as one of them, Jacob, Mario, if some of you guys know them. We got introduced to them through our fantasy football league, and that started because of Matt. You know, I had friends who played, never cared, and then one time me and Matt were playing Madden football, and they had some game mode on there where you can get players. And Matt's all, I wonder if this is what fantasy football's like. He's all, this is pretty cool. And I'm like, it is. And he's like, well, we should get a league together. And I'm like, Matt, there's like us and like four other, you know, teenagers. We can't get a league. And he's like, well, we'll make John and George, a couple other kids who know nothing about sports. So I'm like, all right, we'll do it. We made a league. And through the years, he introduced other people to it. And it was, you know, we have group texts. And none of these, and the bond, the relationship we have, all of us, you know, through prayer. Hey, something's going on, pray. Hey, something's going on here, a sporting event, a family event. The group, we are all so close, and none of it would have happened if not for Matt and his persistence to, hey, let's try this, let's do this. And he was doing it all the way up to the end. With anything in my life personally, like I said, I'm going to share one more story, because I can go on for hours on this, and sometimes I ramble where I forget what I'm talking about. But the last time I got to hang out with Matt, where it was just he and I, we went to a Rams game, and it was, I put out the thing, hey, it's my birthday coming up, you know, I'll get the tickets, does anyone want to go? And we only have one other, you know, we got a bunch of Niner fans in our group, and they're not going to a Rams game, so it was basically me and Matt, we're the only two to go. And he's like, yeah, I'll drive. And we went out there, and we parked, we found some guy who was standing by a gate, and Matt's like, I hope I can trust this guy, if he really is the parking attendant, are we going to get our cars locked in this gated community? But we did it, and I remember going through the thing, and we saw all the festivities and all the people, and Matt's like, yeah, we should tailgate, you know, we can get Dino Dan out here, and we can hang out early game, you know, spend a day of it. It was, for me, it was harder at the time, but I was like, yeah, you know, we talked about how great that would be, and we did everything. If someone has seen the video, Matt went to kick a field goal, and oh man, he shanked it so bad. But we did all the football drills, and it was an incredible time. Then we went to watch the game, and there was an old friend of ours who we grew up, and this guy had like, if something, he had 400 stories. You know, he always had something about how he stopped bank robbers, you know, saved police officers. It was all, so he would randomly call. He had moved, and he would randomly call, and he calls right when we're like 10 minutes from kickoff. And I'm like, I show Matt, I'm like, I'm not answering this phone. And you know who I'm talking about, right, Nick? He knows. And Matt's like, give me the phone. And I'm like, oh, Matt's got to make a joke or something. And Matt's like, hey, what's up, man? And he straight up, until kickoff, talked to him as cool as can be. And I was blown away, because I'm like, I wouldn't have done that. And, you know, I wasn't even going to answer. And just how Matt was just, whoever it was, it doesn't matter. He would take his time. He would share. He would have a great conversation with you. And it impressed me. And I remember the Rams. It was Sean McVay's first game ever as a coach. They won like 44-10. And I remember that to this day, it holds even more value now. I mean, it was one of my favorite Rams game ever. And the fact that me and Matt got to share that. And I'll always cherish that. I'll cherish everything with Matt. He definitely missed. Definitely missed. So thank you very much. Brian.
All right. Let's see how this goes, guys. My name is Brian. For those of you that don't know me, I had the privilege and honor to know Matt. For about 16 years now, when I first heard the news of his passing, I automatically got taken back to the place where I first met him. And we met Matt, we had just gotten out of a Praise Chapel Fullerton at the time, Praise Chapel Fullerton conference. And we were, it was a Bible conference, so you know, we were young, we were on fire for God. And we were walking into a Denny's, and here comes Matt with this group of rocker friends. He's dressed in all black, and his cap on, and then he bumps into one of our friends. We're like, hey, Jesus loves you. And Matt goes, ha, Jesus loves you too. And we started outreaching to Matt right there at the parking lot of that Denny's. And he was kind of blown away, right? He was just like, okay. He had just gotten out of, they had gone to some punk rock concert, and he was all, you know. And then we invited him to Bible study. Like, hey, you guys should go to Bible study. I gave him my number, gave him the address. He goes, shoot me a text. And then we were at Bible study that next following Friday, and sure enough, I get a text from a random number that I'm outside, and I was like, what the heck? Open the door, here comes Matt walking in, and I was like, whoa, this guy just walked into the door. And our friendship took off ever since. It's hard to believe that he's not with us, but I know he's rejoicing in heaven. And he's just been such an impact in my life, and I know in all your life, which is the reason why you took the time to be here this evening. And Matt was very big into sports, right? Very big into stats, and he just had random facts, right? He always texts us, "Hey, it's Bobby Badilla Day." I was like, some guys probably even know that, but like, how do you even know that? He's just like, he just knew those type of things. It was just like a walking encyclopedia when it's sports. We always talk about legacy, right? And what makes a player legendary, right? We talked about, and you talk about a basketball player is about championships, about rings, right? And I was thinking about Matt, and I was thinking about what his legacy is and what his life meant to mine. And honestly, I could say he just has such an impact with everybody that he talked to. And he wasn't the type of person that would just brush you off. He would literally, like Danny said, he would take a phone call no matter what he was doing, and he would take his time to talk to you and hear you out. And I know that all of you have called Matt at one point, and he has answered that phone, and he has had a conversation with you, or he has called you and checked in on you like, "Hey, I haven't heard from you in a while. How are you doing? What's your state of mind?" That's what he would tell me. "What's your state of mind, Brian?" And I'm like, "I'm good." He goes, "Are you sure?" I go, I'm good." He goes, "Talk to me." And then he had a way to bring that out of you, right? He had a way to bring your true problems out, and not just because he wanted to be nosy, but because he wanted to pray for me. He wanted to pray for you. And that's how he was, and that's what he did. So whenever you guys have the opportunity and someone calls you, answer that phone. I want to encourage you guys to be what Matt was to us and be that listening ear, because we don't know what other people are going through and we don't know what struggles they might have. I encourage you to be that ear that Matt was always willing to be for us and that friend that he was for us.
Hello again. Growing up with Matt was obviously a blast. Sharing a room with Matt was a different story. growing up, as Danny said, we were always, you know, together as far as when we were in Calvary or on the same team, or if they were, you know, making a youth group, you know, these kids go with that teacher, these kids go with that teacher. We were always together. And, you know, looking back, my brother was very kept to himself as a kid, quiet. I wouldn't say shy because he always had his group of friends, like CJ, Pidge. I think his name's Conrad. Yeah, his name's Conrad. A couple of kids from Calvary who he was close to, but he wasn't as outgoing as I was. And as he got older, I see now that the guitar and worship really brought that outgoing personality out of Matt. Being up on stage, worshiping is where he felt most like Matt. And that's where I'm sure that's where he is right now, throwing a riff into worship, saying we don't need to practice, just, you know, let the Spirit lead. But they have an eternity for that now, so. Although my brother and I had different jobs and careers, we were very much alike. When he was here, he was a youth leader. When he moved, he was a youth leader. I myself am a school teacher. And as much as I feel like we may have been different or went down different roads, I feel like as we got older, the more alike we became. Something I want to ask all of you, and Brian kind of touched on that, is however Matthew affected your life, I want you to take that flame or that encouragement, that light, and shed it on somebody else. I look forward to our vacations teaching Silas, Elijah, and Ellison how to fish, letting them climb on rocks and jump off and hopefully not get hurt. Doing all the things that we wish me and Matthew talked about doing together. We're still going to do all those things. And I know that, you know, Brian, although you moved, we're going to stay in touch. We're going to visit and hang out just like, you know, we do in our fantasy football league and other events. But I just want to thank everybody, including his family in Oklahoma, for being Matt's friend. And making him part of your family like he made you part of his. Next, my cousin Johnny's going to read a letter from our Aunt Terry, who is a missionary in the Philippines. Thank you.
How loud is this thing? My name is John. Known by my family, a lot of them is Johnny. I'm going to read a letter that my aunt, who is in the Philippines and couldn't be here, wanted me to read. Good evening. Hi, my name is Terry. I am one of Matthew's aunts. I don't know really where to begin, as Matthew was and is a huge blessing to me. As I reflect on Matthew's life, remembering his simple joys of life, one of my favorite memories is how he loved to watch Jungle Book. I remember that too. I think he pretty much watched it every day. Matthew could sing, dance, and follow all the actions of the animals, even at times making my brother John pause, my Uncle Jack, pause the movie so he could get props from the kitchen to follow all the actions of the movie. I moved to the Philippines as a missionary when Matt was little. So as I was reflecting on Matthew's life, I realized I missed all the important moments in his life. Watching him get baptized, all his graduations, kinder, middle school, high school, getting his driver's license, his wedding, as he married the love of his life, Atlanta, and the birth of their children. But one thing I won't miss is spending eternity with him, with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I love you, Matthew. This verse, I think, describes Matthew's life. Imitate me just as I also imitate Christ. 1 Corinthians 11:1. Matthew means gift of the Lord. Truly, he was a wonderful gift from God to us all. I love you, Matthew, and I'm so thankful to the Lord for letting me be a part of your life and being your aunt.
I met Matthew when I was 2 years old. I was his cousin. My mom showed me baby pictures of him. I was like, oh, I guess I actually held him. I don't remember that. My first memory of him was when I was staying over at their house. Sometime after Nick was born, he gave Nick a cup of water because he was acting, he was a little upset. He was young. He told me, careful, he'll bite you if you get your hands too close to his mouth. But yeah, like, Nick and everyone says he was very competitive. As his manager for fantasy football, I will tell you, I had to change the rules. He would change his quarterback 20 minutes before the game starts and you would lose. He did that for many a year. Remember one time when I was a kid, we were all playing miniature golf, I touched the ball and I got whacked with the club. Very true story. But yeah, we've been close growing up. He was a groomsman at my wedding. Along with Nick, that was one of the funnest times. We all did King's game, had a lot of fun, had a picture together, the three of us. That was great. Yeah. Doesn't make a whole lot of sense what's been going on. Found out the day that my son was born that happened. I don't think that's what he wants us to focus on, though. Life is short. That's what Solomon said. It is a vapor, fleeting moment. His life was all about Christ. That's what he would want us to focus on. We're here for a very small period of time, and then it's that. We will all be with him soon, and that's what he'd want us to focus on. He'll watch over all of us and his family. All of us are his friends, and he'll be with all of us. That's what I wanted to say.
You know, everybody has a story. I have a couple. And Matt was very close with my family, with my boys. And just like how everybody is saying how competitive he was, and they would go to Buffalo Wild Wings, one of their favorite places, and they would sit down, and Matt introduced a saying to my sons that I started noticing being said over and over and over in my home again. And this is how the saying goes: "You won't do it. You won't do it." And so my sons, being much younger, they're like, "Okay." So they're Buffalo Wild Wings, eating like crazy habanero wings because Matt is challenging them to do it. And we have this one picture of Matt and my sons and Jacob and a couple other guys, and Matt sweating profusely. And you look at him and look like he's crying. He's like. And he's like holding up the wing, you know, and I'm looking at this guy, I'm like, this guy's crazy, you know? But as my boys got a little bit older, they go, you know, one day you're gonna have sons, and we're gonna take them to Buffalo Wild Wings, and we're gonna talk to your sons about, you won't do it. And he's like, no way, bro, I'm not gonna let that happen, blah, blah, blah. But you know what I love so much about Matt's life is that he touched everybody in a very, very personal way. But the personal way in which he did it was, it all flowed from that same place, that place where he wanted to make sure that he was making an impact in somebody's life. He built friendships that were going to last him forever. And I started thinking about all of the different things that we could talk about when we come together in a memorial service. And there is a passage of scripture that I like to minister on. But with Matt, it's like it made so much more sense to minister it, because it really truly tells a story of somebody who was gone too soon, a friend and people that were upset because this person was gone. And the Bible says in John chapter 11, verse 1, it says, "Now, there was a certain man who was sick. His name was Lazarus of Bethany in the village of Mary and her sister Martha. And it was Mary who had anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. And so the sister sent word to him saying, 'Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick.' But when Jesus heard this, he said, 'This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, so that the Son of God might be glorified by it.' Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus." Now, the reason why I wanted to emphasize that point was because when you hear the rest of the story, and it's a very, very famous story, many of you already know it, but when you hear the rest of the story, it would seem that Jesus didn't love them. Because when we have friends, and Lazarus and Mary and Martha were friends with Jesus, they were connected with you. When we tend to think about the Lord, we tend to think about him high and lifted up and his glory and everything else. But, you know, when he walked on earth as a man, he had friendships, tight friendships, you know, fantasy football league friendships. He had those connections with certain people. And when Jesus would go to the town called Bethany, he would stay at the house of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And so they expected that when Jesus heard that he was sick, that he would come running. Because that's what good friends do, right? When you're in trouble, you know who you can call and who you can't. You know who's going to come running, and no matter where you're at, whether you're in a place good or you're in a place bad, you know there's those certain individuals that you can call that are going to come running and bail you out. And they had this type of a relationship with Jesus. And so they sent word to him, and they said, "The one that you love is sick." And then Jesus decided that, no, I'm going to wait a little while longer. Verse 6 says, "So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed in the place 2 days longer in the place that where he was. And then after this, he said to the disciples, 'Let us go to Judea again.' And the disciples said to him, 'Rabbi, the Jews were just seeking to stone you, and you're going to go there again.' And Jesus answered, 'Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anybody walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if anybody walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him.' And then he said, and after that, he said to them, 'Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go so that I might awaken him out of his sleep.' And the disciples said to him, 'Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he's going to recover.' And Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought he was speaking of literal sleep. And Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And look at what it says. And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you might believe. But let us go to him. Why do you think that he said that? Because I absolutely believe that if Jesus would have been there, he wouldn't have let Lazarus die. The friendship, the connection was there. And when we see our friends hurting, or we see them fall to the side and leave us so unexpectedly, it hurts us to the point to where if we could, we would have saved them. Because ultimately, that's what Jesus could have done. He could have saved them. So much to the point to where he says, Lazarus is dead, and I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, because I absolutely believe that if he would have been there, he wouldn't have let him die. He loved him too much. Therefore, Thomas, who was called Didymus, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we might die with him. Radical guy. So when Jesus came and he found that he had already been in the tomb 4 days, now Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning the brother. And Martha therefore, when she heard that she was coming, went to meet him, but Mary stayed at the house. You have two types of people when tragedy strikes like this. You have one type that's going to run and let you know exactly how they feel about why you weren't here. All of us have had those types of situations where we expected somebody to come and they didn't. And as soon as we heard that they were anywhere in our proximity, we had to let them know you should have been here. And then you have the other type, the one that will just kind of sit back solemnly, still hurt, still wounded, but yet still not so much to where they're going to go and be accusatory, feeling it the same way, but the constitution of the personality just doesn't allow them to do that. And that's what we see with Mary and Martha here. It says, Martha then said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. You know, when we read that scripture, we can kind of just read it and blast right by it, but I don't really think that it went that way. Because when you have the opportunity to talk to a friend, remember we're talking about close friends, and they burned you, you don't talk to them just like regular. Bro, if you had been here, if you had just done what you were supposed to do, are you seeing what I'm saying? There are those, because those types of relationships can handle that type of a weight. I believe that that's what happened when this particular tone came out from her. Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said to him, I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection of the last day. The reason why I laugh at that is because I think that Martha, and I really don't think I'm reading too much into the scripture. I don't think I'm going beyond the pale of orthodoxy here. I really do believe that it was like, the resurrection of the last day. Because, you know, sometimes when you get mad at your friends, it's like it doesn't matter what they tell you. It's like you're still feeling the hurt inside. You're still feeling the pain that's in there. And many of us are here this evening because we're still feeling that pain. And we know, we hear people come up, he's in a better place, and he's worshiping. Even myself, I said, you know, he's having a wonderful time there in heaven. It's like, yeah, I know heaven, but what about this side? What about earth? What about his babies that will grow up without their daddy? What about this? What about that, pastor, preacher? What about that? And you know, to be honest, I'm with you too. I feel that same way. I'm like, Lord, you know, there could have been anybody, but why him? So young, married so young, baby so young, a daughter just born to him. But we don't know. I wish I could give you the answer, but we don't know. Jesus turns around though and he says to her, verse 25 goes, I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? See, because Christ, we don't hurt God's feelings when we come to him with very pointed questions. We don't hurt his feelings. But he turns around and he puts the ball right back in our court and he says, do you believe it? Do you believe that I am the resurrection? Do you believe that you will see Matt again? See, because now what happens is a paradigm shift has to begin to happen inside of our mind if we're going to really say yes. She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even he who comes into the world. And when she had said this, she went away, and she called Mary, her sister, secretly, the teacher is here, and he's calling for you. And when she heard it, she got up quickly and was coming to him. Now, Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. And then the Jews who were there with her in the house, consoling her, when they saw that Mary got up quickly and went out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. And therefore, when Mary came where Jesus was, she saw him, and she fell at his feet, saying to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." And when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit, and he was troubled. And he said, "Where have you laid him?" You know, I look at that, and I see how Christ sees the pain and the hurt of everybody, not just in this story. The Bible says that God loves you so much that he captures every tear you cry in a bottle. It's so important to him. And he isn't not touched with our pain and with our hurting. He's absolutely touched. And I really believe that at this point, Jesus was saying, "Okay, enough's enough." He goes, "Where have you laid him?" And they said to him, "Lord, come and see." And Jesus wept. Why? Why did he weep? If he knew what he was going to do, and I love that part of the story too. If he knew what he was going to do with Lazarus, why weep? Because he's touched by the pain that we feel. He sees what gaping holes death leaves in a family. In the absence of a father or a mother who left us too soon, he sees that, he understands that it hurts him, it crushes him. But the Bible says that he resurrected from the dead just so that he would also have the keys to death, hell, and the grave. That there's nothing that we're going to be able to, there's nothing that we're going to encounter in this life that as long as our faith is in Christ, do you believe this? That we won't be able to hold on to and see him again. So the Jews were saying, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not this man who opened the eyes of the blind have kept this man also from dying?" So Jesus, again, being deeply moved within, came to the tomb. Now, it was a cave, and the stone was lying against it. And Jesus said, "Remove the stone." And Martha, the sister of the deceased, said to him, "Lord, by this time, there'll be a stench, for he's been dead for 4 days." And Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" See, because sometimes it's like, "Oh, Lord, if you would have been here before he died, you could have saved him, but Lord, it's too late now. He's gone. There's no way that he can be restored to us." And he goes, "Wait, hold on. Didn't we just talk about this? Didn't you say?" "Yes, I said." And so he continues on. He says, and Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you that if you believe, you're going to see the glory of God?" So they removed the stone. And then Jesus raised his eyes and he said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you would always hear me. But because of the people that are standing around, I said it so they might believe you, that you sent me." And when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth." You know, a few years ago, I thought about the scripture as I was studying it. And we tend to see the dramas or the movies and Jesus standing before the tomb of the dead man, Lazarus, and calling out to the tomb, and here comes Lazarus. But sometimes we don't really kind of think about it. We just tend to think that the voice came out of the mouth of Christ, hit the back of the cave, touched Lazarus' body, and brought him back. But Lazarus had been gone for 4 days. He was gone. He had slipped from mortality to immortality. The Bible says that he was in Abraham's bosom, completely away from this place that everybody else was standing. The only thing that was left that was there was a shell. Can you imagine just for a moment, just be with me for a moment, when to think that Lazarus was sitting in paradise and all of a sudden a voice comes that leaves the mouth of Jesus, goes into the tomb, but doesn't stop there, leaves this particular atmosphere, goes into the heavenlies to the point to where Lazarus is sitting and he hears Jesus calling him because he knows the voice of Jesus. They're friends. "Lazarus, come forth." And him not having a will to say no. Bible says that he was wrapped up in grave clothes. I think that if that happened with us and Matt, he would be so mad. He's like, "Are you serious? I was in that place, man. I was with Jesus. I was, you know." But it's like, well, so we tend to focus so much on the pain and not really focus on that place where He is. And it's natural. Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, said there's a time for everything under the sun, a time for mourning, a time when pain is going to hit our hearts. It helps us to keep this world from becoming too attractive. Reminds us that God has a better home for us. Verse 44, and the man who died came forth, bound hand and foot with wrappings, and his face was wrapped around him with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. I would love it if I could tell you that that was the story that happened with our brother Matthew. But it wasn't. He's on that side of heaven now. I know it hurts, John, Kathy, and the lad. I know it hurts. But yet still, I know that there's no place he'd rather be. Because the Bible says, that's not to say that he wouldn't be sad if he could have the capacity to be sad. The Bible says that when you go to heaven, there is no sadness there. There is no pain. The pain is for this side, for us to remember and remind ourselves of how great a friend he was, all of the wonderful things that he did, the ways that he made us laugh. I think about that time when Obi was talking about a little bit earlier when he was playing that guitar. And he dropped his pick, and rather than just stopping, and this was just, you guys know, this was just his personality. Rather than stopping for a moment, reaching down, picking up the pick, and taking it out, he just kept going to where he's going so much that his hands are bleeding, and he's playing. And they're like, dude, why didn't you stop? He's like, I don't want to mess up the worship song. And in the zone, man, you're in that place, you know? And I'm like, this guy's crazy. He's radical. And now he's radical playing in a band that we couldn't even imagine what the sound sounds like. And I know it hurts, lady. John, Kathy, that I know it hurts. I know it's painful. He was my friend too. But we're here because of the impact that he's made on us. You know, I sit and I look at the worship team that was here, and it wasn't any small contribution of Matt. It was huge, the contribution that he deposited inside of Ariel, inside of all of the musicians, all of the singers. To where now, even now, to this day, it's still bearing fruit. People are still being blessed by music that was deposited because of his gift. His babies are growing up with a legacy. I can't wait till they start picking up a guitar. They're not even going to know why they're so good at it. You see, Silas was running up here already. He's like, give me that guitar. I'm ready to rock. But I just want to encourage you guys and console you a bit if I can. I'll let you guys know that I love Matt. I loved him just the way that you guys do. Some of you guys, just by way of the connection that you guys had, you guys loved him much more deeply than I ever could. But he is in a better place. He is in the place that all of us have the opportunity to go to one day. But we also have to ask ourselves to it. And that's the question that you got to kind of step away from and ask yourself the question, going, man, is my life making an impact? I want to make an impact. Because our life really is, it's just, it's here one moment, and it's gone the next. Will you close your eyes and bow your heads with me as we pray? Father, again, we love you, and we thank you for bringing us to this place. And we ask, Lord God, as stories continue, Lord God, and even as this portion of the service ends and we go and we eat, Lord God, let our conversation be filled with how that young man touched our hearts and our lives. Let us remind ourselves, Lord God, of all of the distinctive ways that his smile lit up our hearts. Lord God, he was gone way too soon. And to be honest, there are those times when I kind of feel the same way, Lord. If you had just done what you could do, and we know it, we believe it, we see it inside the Word, but yet you chose in your wisdom and in your grace and in your glory, Lord God, to take him home. And so then, Lord God, help us on this side of heaven. Help us, Lord God, to be consoled and encouraged, Lord, knowing that he's there worshiping, but also, too, that we'll see him again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We have a portion of time for the service dedicated to an open mic for friends and family that would like to come. But before we do that, we have a quick video from some friends that were in Oklahoma that couldn't make it down here, and we wanted to go ahead and show you guys those videos. So go ahead and throw that on up there, guys.
Hi, my name is Anthony Robles, and I had the privilege of growing up with the Rotherhams. I got to spend a lot of time with them throughout my childhood, and Those are the brightest moments of my childhood, and I'm extremely grateful for the time I got to spend with them. Growing up, Matt was always just wise beyond his years. He was an old soul. I know many, many people can speak to that and who he was. I'm really grateful that I got to have such an amazing childhood with them, but not only that, in the later years when we became men, that we were all still so close. Matt always found a way into a church. He always threw himself into it. He was always so serving. He had such an ability to step in, become a musician, always did worship. And I loved it. I loved to see it. And he was just somebody I was so proud to be friends with and to know. He admired church. He admired the people. He admired serving. And I just love him so much for that. When Matt spoke, it was always with conviction, especially on subjects that he felt strongly about. And I was always happy when I got to hang out with him, because it was like I get to enjoy Matt's perspective and how strongly he feels about it whenever I knew we were going to have a conversation that he necessarily didn't agree. Seeing Matt become a father and a husband was just amazing. The courage it takes to leave your comfort zone and step outside of that to provide for your family, to make sure that in the long run they're taken care of, is admirable at the least. And he did it. He did it. And he did it for Atlanta. He did it for his kids. And it was just amazing. I had the privilege of being able to travel back and forth between Kansas and Oklahoma and spending time with the family. And then his church family also. And the only thing I can take away from it is how consistent Matthew was in every aspect of his life. He was consistent at home with being a father, a husband, loving God, putting God first in that, in the church, consistent in loving and serving. He was there for the youth. I loved hearing about all the stories about how much growth there was the moment he planted himself into the church and he gave it his all. And it's just inspired me in my life, and I just hope it inspires everybody else also to be more consistent in your life. Be who you are at all times. Stand by your beliefs, stand by your convictions, and just serve and love. It's something that I'm gonna carry with me for the rest of my life. I just wanna say thank you to the Rotherhams, Kathy and John. I love you guys so much, and I'm so grateful to have you guys a part of my life. Nick, you are the strongest man I know. For what you've dealt with, what you've picked up, and the way you've handled yourself, I'll never be able to understand it, but I respect it so much. And I love you. And Bobby, Matt loved you so much. And he wanted the best for you. He really cared about you. I'm gonna miss the conversations and the text messages between all three of us. But I love everybody. I love you guys. And I just wanna say thank you for allowing me to be a part of it in any type of way. I love you, Matt. And I'll see you soon, man.
Hi, my name is Bobby. I first met Matthew in Atlanta at Guts in our youth department. Anytime anyone's new, they always like to stick them with someone who's been there for a while. And me and my wife had been serving probably 21 years at the time. So they stuck Matthew with me in small groups. Typically, we don't let anyone who's new talk, but man, I could just tell, like, he was chewing at the bit, like, okay, he had something to say. And I was like, you know what? I really felt comfortable with him. So I was like, hey, man, you got something to say? And he pretty much ended up, like, leading the small group. I mean, he was just phenomenal. I could tell his passion for God and for the youth was at a real high level. So I knew, you know, from early on that we would just be great friends for the rest of our lives, regardless if he moved away or stayed. Like, it was just an immediate bond. Just constantly, just his personality was just kind of the life of the party. Loved to have people over at his house for barbecuing, and for he loved his grills and smoking meats, and just having people over, just constantly inviting everyone over, as many people as he could. It's a big loss not having him around right now, but you know, my couple of first initial reactions were to pull back, because we don't know how to explain these type of things, but I really felt like the Holy Spirit kind of just whispered to me a couple of things. One is, God is going to turn this to good. I don't know how, I don't know when, but it will happen. Another thing is that life is like a vapor, and it's, you know, so you're really not promised tomorrow. It was just a couple of days before we were over and brought him some food, and it was a Sunday after church, and he told my wife that, you know, he just doesn't, like, for him, life couldn't be any better. He, you know, he said he had this great house, he had this great family, he had his great friends, and he was so thankful for everyone that he worked with, everyone, all of the friends and stuff at church, all of his family is so proud. You know, he bragged on his brothers all the time and said, man, just like how they're like overcoming things. And so I've got to meet both the brothers and became friends just instantly, just like Matthew. So, you know, you guys are super important, especially with his kids and helping raise up those two little boys and that new little girl. So just know that God will turn this around for good somehow. And yeah, that's what I'm standing on. I'm believing that God is faithful, and we're praying and believing God that everything will be okay. He was just an amazing guy. I could talk for days of all the stories, and he was just so happy, and like, he just made it fun. We're going to miss him, but we're going to see him someday soon in heaven. So God bless you guys. And Matt, we'll see you soon.
Hi, my name is Opetavai. I have the honor of sharing a little bit about my brother Matt, my dear friend Matt. Thank you so much to the Rotherham family for allowing me to share a little bit about Matt today. And the way I met Matt was crazy. I met Matt, I think they'd been here for 2 weeks in Oklahoma. And I remember meeting him. It was an early morning and we had Bible reading. And I remember him wearing this USC hat. And he's either wearing a USC hat, a Dodgers hat, or a Rams hat, but I remember him wearing a USC hat this day, and it's one of my favorite teams or colleges. And I remember, like, I gotta go meet that guy. There's not too many of us USC fans here in Oklahoma. Later on that day, during this thing called Friday groceries, I saw the same USC hat, and on his way to his car, God put it on my heart to bless him with whatever I had in my pocket. I said, hey man, I don't do this. I shouldn't do this, but I'm here's what I have. And he looked at me and he just, like, he broke down. He said, like, you have no idea. I just prayed for this. My car is on empty. And I literally prayed for this on my way to my car. That was our initial meet. And from that day on, my life was forever changed. I remember him texting me that day, thank you, here's my number, can't wait to see you Sunday. Man, I said, I'd love for you guys to sit with us. And they got their Sunday, they ended up going to Next Step, and they served their hearts out, and they were, man, so faithful. The coolest thing about Matt in Atlanta through this time was I got to see the quick return on Psalm 92:13. Psalm 92:13 says that those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. I saw the flourishing as soon as they were planted. As soon as they were planted, I saw the jobs come. They were new to Oklahoma. They were looking for opportunities. The jobs came. And then the kids came. And the house came. And everything that I got to see, got to witness, it was just God's faithfulness. But because of their obedience to be planted, it was the coolest thing. I had front row seats to it. I will forever cherish, man, the times that we had, Matt. Always looking for the next time that we'd all get to connect and fellowship and hang out. One of the most welcoming people I know, one of the most down people I know. And I say down like he served with me in junior high. And if I asked him to run a game or do a worship song or do check-in or pray with kids or run a small group, whatever it was, his answer was, I'm down. I hope that I'm that way as well. And it was an honor to witness someone be obedient, faithful, and just down for whatever. Atlanta, Silas, Elijah, Ellison, man, it was an honor to know your husband, your dad, a great man of God who loved you very much. Mr. and Mrs. Rotherham, thank you so much for, man, raising this man of God. I'm so honored to have been a part of his life. I'm so honored that he's been a part of mine and has forever, like, changed the trajectory of my life because I got to know him. Thank you. Love you and miss you, Matt.
We have two microphones, one set up here on the right and one on the left. So one's closer to you if you would like to come and say a few words. Anybody from the family or friends that would like to come and say a few words, please go ahead and come on up. You guys can line up if you want. I know everybody has a story, but at the same time, too, I understand it's a difficult time. Sometimes it's hard to kind of get the words out, but I'll wait a moment to see.
We go. I'm Uncle Bob. Matt, there's not one memory that I have of any of the times that I spent with Matt that were negative. Everything, every time I spent with him was positive, uplifting, and funny, and just he was always, always up and always about you and about just having a nice time together and just being, you know, just he was there for you. And he connected with you and he wanted to be a part of whatever you were doing. Some of the fond memories I have with him, and I want to thank Jack and Kathy, was when I was allowed to play guitar with him when he was first learning. Those are cherished memories that I'll have. And the latest that we saw him was recently at the Eitner's, where he was barbecuing for everybody and just yucking it up with all of us, and we were having a great time. I have some very fond memories of Matt, and Jack and Kathy, you did a beautiful job raising him.
Anybody else?
Hello. I had the privilege of being part, my husband and I pastored at the Norwalk Church with a bunch of wonderful people, and Matt was one of them. And I just want to share some stories, well, maybe two stories, of how my children interacted with Matt. The very first time Matt came over was, I think it was a Bible study night, and my youngest son was, I think, five. And Matt was sitting on a chair, obviously, but like against the wall, and everybody was kind of fellowshipping. And my five-year-old comes over, runs over to Matt, sits on his lap, puts his arms around him, and Matt's going like, "Hi." And my little one's going, "Hi, Matt, how are you?" Because my family is we're a very huggy, touchy-feely family. And so I'm sitting there going like, "Oh, my gosh." And Matt's going, "Hi." He didn't know what to do with the kid. And I had a, "Benjamin, get down from Matt." And he's like, "Okay." He jumped down, and Matt's looking at me. I'm like, "Sorry, like, that's just my kid." And it was just a wonderful moment just to see Matt's reaction with my youngest. My youngest is now 19. That's how long we've known Matt. And my other son, he was the drummer. I don't know if you're going to come up and share, but I'm going to share for you. My son Obadiah was 12 years old, 13 maybe, and he would go up to Matt almost every service, and he would say, "Matt, you have the most beautiful eyes." And Matt would look at him like, "Thanks, like, you're a weird kid." And I remember hearing, walking by in church, and he's just going, "Matt, you have the most beautiful eyes," just gazing in his eyes. And Matt was just like, "Thanks, Obi." You know, and he must have thought our family was a little off. But, you know, again, we're a very lovey, touchy-feeling family, especially my son Obadiah. But what I do remember the most is being part of the worship team and the freedom that he had to just worship God. It was so contagious. And even though I loved worshiping God at home, being at church was a little different story because you didn't want to get too crazy, you know. But watching him being in front of the pulpit, and he was always on my left because I would always have to give him the sign, you know, chorus, verse one, verse two, you know. And he was always just like strumming, and he would just get down as, you know, the bleeding hands. That was our church. And watching him worship the Lord just so free, it was so contagious that we got that from him. And we said, "Okay, this is it." And, you know, I would always say he'd egg on my kids, but it was a positive egging on, you know. And Obi would play the drums, and I know that they would look at each other, and I would go, "Don't look at each other when we're doing worship. Can you just look, you know?" But I know Matt would look at him, and they're like, "Yeah, we know where we're going, and, you know, let's go back to the bridge." And it was just amazing, the heart, the joy, the love that he just like shed. He just gave. And I remember when he was started dating Atlanta, he goes, we would text every once in a while, and he's like, "Oh, we went out to eat, blah, blah." And he goes, It's so easy to talk to her. It's so easy to just share things of God with her. And I'm just like,
that's it, man. Like, that's it. And I know that he loved you dearly, dearly, Atlanta. And I'm just very grateful and thankful for the impact that Matt made, not just in my life, but in my children's lives, my husband, in our church. And he allowed us, God used him and the team, our team, to take us to the next level of worship. And that's why we were up here just worshiping God, because that's what Matt did. He worshiped. It didn't matter who was looking or who was not looking. He just worshiped. And I'm just so grateful for the time that we had with him.
Mauro, you go first.
Hello. My name is Mario. I've known Matt for 15 years. And one story I want to share with you guys is he used to work with me. We did construction together. And there was a time that work was slow. So I told Matt, you know, how about going to Flappy Jacks? He's like, yeah, I'm down. So we're on our way to Flappy Jacks. We're sitting down, we're eating breakfast. He's like, dude, I can't believe it. I'm getting paid for this. I'm like, don't worry about it. We'll take care of it. You're okay. He's like, we did this for a week. And he's like, I'm loving this. And those of you who know Matt, he loves to eat. Yeah. So that's one of the stories that I have. In last July, he texted me. He sent me a picture of the bathroom that he was doing, the toilet that he put in. And he's all like, how does it look? I'm like, it looks great. He's all like, I haven't forgotten all those lessons that you helped me out with, all the construction stuff. And just to know that he's not here, you know. But I know he's in heaven, looking out, smiling, eating probably something. You know, he's probably munching on something. But I'm going to miss him in Atlanta. Love you guys, Kathy and John, Nick. I'm so grateful I got to know you guys through him. And like they say, my football team, the fantasy team that we have, it's all because of him. I got in that football fantasy league because of him. And just the people that I met through him, because of him, things that I learned through him. But we'll miss him. I love you, Matt.
Hi, guys. I'm the son that said, wow, your beautiful green eyes. That was me. I was only, when I met Matt, I was 12 years old, and I had the honor and privilege of worshiping with this man of God. And I'm already going to cry, but without him, I wouldn't be probably in church. It's funny now, but I went during youth. I was never in the service. I was never in the service. I was on the worship team for so long, and I was never part of the youth group. I always kind of felt like I had a chip on my shoulder because I was on the worship team, and I was like, oh, I don't really need to do this. And throughout high school, I was never part of the worship team. I was never part of the youth group. And he would always text me, hey, man, how's it going? Like, good, Matt. Like, can you leave me alone? You know, but, and I was always like, okay, Matt, like, because I've always had that. I've always had you need to be in church. You need to do this. You need to do that. But he would always text me, and I go, okay, Matt, yeah, okay. But he, and my mom was talking about it earlier. He had so much liberty because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's freedom. And he carried the Spirit of the Lord that was with him, just like how David did when he would play with Saul. And when he would play, he wasn't just playing, he was playing prophetically. and he was playing and he was strumming, and we were so intertwined. We were so connected, because there was times where my mom was leading the worship and her body language was already in the motion of going back to the bridge, going back to the chorus, going back to the verse. And Matt would just look at me and I would already shake my head, and we'd go back into the chorus or the verse or wherever she even would want to go. And we would get into that presence of the Lord. And I want to thank him personally, because without him, I would probably still just be the drummer. Without him, I'd probably not be in church. He showed me how to play. He showed me how to play prophetically. Even though he never got with me one-on-one, he showed me how to have liberty in the Lord. I just look at my mom and she's crying and I'm crying now. But he showed me how to have liberty when I'm playing. Not just to be like, you need to have one song here, one song there, one song there. Two slow songs, two fast songs. He showed us how to flip it around. He showed us that the Spirit of the Lord is no one to be contained in a box. He showed us how to do these things. And it wasn't just, he didn't take it lightly worshiping the Lord, our sovereign Lord. And if it wasn't for him, He impacted us. That's why you're here today. It's because he impacted you. The impact wasn't just for now. It wasn't just for me. It was for generations after. And he exhibited. I could go on and on. I could be preaching to you guys. But he went on and on and on. He taught me. He gave me that guitar. And I guarantee you, if he didn't give me that guitar, I wouldn't be playing the guitar that led to the piano. Because I had this cheap, nasty, grimy, corroded. You would plug it in and all you heard was... I had this trash guitar, and he knew I had that guitar, and he goes, "Are you gonna practice?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm gonna practice." And he goes, "Are you sure? Because I don't wanna do what I'm gonna do and you not practice." And I go, "What do you mean?" And he opens the trunk of his car and he gave me that guitar. And I just sent him a text, and we were all worshiping over here, and I go, "Thank you for that guitar you gave me." And now I'm teaching this next generation how to play the guitar, and we have a literal 12-year-old playing with us on the guitar, because Matt made the impact on me. And who am I? Freely you shall receive, freely you shall give. So just how Matt imparted into us, so also we shall give to the next generation. I love Matt. Praise the Lord.
Hello, everybody. My name is Eliza, and I am one of the many people that Matt impacted. Don't look at me, Elena. Matt came into my life when I was like 9, 10, a very, very transitional period for my family. And he brought the love of God. We were going to church, and he was at my house like every single day, always throwing up, because Matt used to always throw up. I don't know. We'd be playing games, and he'd be like, "I'm down," and then he'd be the one throwing up. But every single day that he was there, you heard my dad, and he was close to my family, and he brought love back into my house. My family were close now, but Matt helped with that. Matt was there through it, and he was like, I was really stubborn, not that stubborn anymore, but he was like, "It's okay to, like, love them." And I was like, "Okay." And I'm just really thankful, because you guys really did good. Everybody's telling you did a great job, because you did. He touched so many people, and I feel like he was here on the earth. I know he was exactly 10 years older than me, and he was here for 32 years. God gave him a giant bucket of seeds, and he planted them. He just threw them everywhere, and we're all just seeds. So we need to have fruition and just give the glory to God through it all, because that's what Matt would want. And like everybody's saying, he's up there having so much fun with all the angels worshiping and throwing up on the gold football. But Matt, Alana, your family, I love you guys, and God's going to comfort us, and I love you all, and Matt loves you.
So I was the one that did the Valentine's hookup. So God uses everything. He used my singleness to bring Matt and Alana together. He used my singleness and you guys coming together to water faith back into my life. And he came to the party because he thought it was a dumb party. And all night I was like, I'm watching you. Because I already saw it happening. But I didn't see where it was going to go. But God did. God knew. And you know, he had his own plans of trying to get me married, but God had a different plan. And so it was awesome just to watch you guys come together. And like I told you, Alana, watching you guys do that, we was him. It was him dancing the night away, but dancing and worshiping God was who he was. That's who he was. And I remember when I would get caught up in worship, I remember Vettel saying, he said, why is Maria getting excited? She goes, that's how she worships. And I remember today when I was worshiping, I was like, I'm worshiping because this is what he saw. He loved to see you worship, and he loved to you not to care who was next to you or who was staring at you. And that's who God is. He's a God we could worship forever. And I said, like, to you, Alana, he is worshiping in the best way right now, and we miss him, but just knowing that he's getting the best of God. And he had the best of you here, and now he has the best, and God is going to do what he promised. He will turn this moment of sorrow into joy, and we will get to watch it happen, and that will grow all our faith here today. Thank you.
Okay, last call. All right.
I'm Matt's cousin. It's been really awesome to hear all your guys' stories and all the family that he had that we didn't know about. You know, I don't know many of you. I would like to say I was more involved in his life in the later years, but, you know, life happens, and I wasn't always around. I wasn't always the best cousin, but I have a lot of good memories of Matthew, too. I remember him throwing up, too. In my mom's car. He used to get car sick, and I remember spending the night at my Uncle Jack and Aunt Kathy's house and staying up too late and getting yelled at from the upstairs and getting in trouble and all that stuff. And I love Matt so much, and we all miss him so much. And there's a saying that goes around in Christian circles that God will never give you more than you can handle. And I just want to tell everybody here, it's a lie. I can't handle my cousin being gone. I can't handle that he left this world so early and so young. And it's okay to feel that. It's okay to be grieving and have sorrow. And I want to read something from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 1, starting in verse 8. It says, "For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of the affliction we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired even of life itself. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death." But, that's always a good word in the Bible. But, that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. God raises the dead. This is not the end of the story. Sometimes God does give us more than we can handle, but he can handle it. And we just need to trust. I have no idea why. It makes absolutely no sense why he would leave this world so early and so young. But God has a plan. God always has a plan. And whether we understand it or not, we need to trust in him, put our faith in him, and be there for the family that's left. And thank you all.
We have one more video we're going to show.
Matthew wasn't perfect, but he
was perfect for us.
He truly saw every human as God saw them.
He would help absolutely anyone at any time.
I've prayed for Matthew since I was 16 years old.
We met at a Valentine's Day party, and I had no idea both our lives would be changed forever that night.
The last six years have been so full of unconditional love.
Matthew never complained.
He was always eager to help.
His passion for worship and serving the church was an inspiration.
His faith carried me through so many times.
His 32 years of life was the best anyone could ask for.
His family loved him so much.
His boys always wanted to be near him, and were so excited when he got home.
Anytime he even looked at Ellison, he said how much he loved her
and how perfect she was.
His legacy will live on.
Matthew loved me with his whole being.
He always provided anything and everything I needed or wanted.
Anytime I was worried,
Matthew would say our family motto,
"I believe,"
and he wouldn't budge
until I said it back.
Now, as we continue each day, waiting to be welcomed to our eternal home,
we will continuously say,
I believe, now and forever.
All we do is we're living testing with every single day, whether you crazy things, whether you have to have crazy. There's a person for your story to be shared with.
Amen.
Thank you. First off, I don't want to look up. But I want to thank you all for coming. It means an absolute world to me that you came to show your support and love. Matthew loved each and every single one of you. And he told me stories upon stories that I always loved hearing him relive every detail because he just spoke so well and he just had the best stories. But what I want to say is that God has a purpose for each and every single one of us. And Matthew's finished his race, And I'm not sure why he had to run it so fast since he didn't even like running. But now he has the ultimate prize. He is doing what he does best. He's worshiping Jesus with everything he has. And he gets to take care of our two babies that we lost previously. I miss Matthew, and I will forever love him. Sorry. But God has called me, and he's called you to continue to live on and continue our race. Romans 8, verse 28 says, all things work together. So I know this pain won't be purposeless. It will work together to build God's kingdom. And I pray that Matthew's life, his joy, his positive outlook, and his unbreakable faith has been a testimony to you. And you've seen a good God through him and through our family. And so, if you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, and you have felt his love and his presence tonight, and you want to do that, Romans 10:9 says, if you openly declare that Jesus is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. And so as I pray us out, I will pray the salvation prayer, and you, if you decide to do so, you can pray with me. Dear God, we thank you so much for the time that we got to spend with Matthew. You orchestrated all of it, all of our lives together in the most perfect way. Your heart was broken just as much as ours was the day that Matthew left and the day that Jesus died for us on the cross. Right now, we confess your son, Jesus, as the Lord of our lives. Thank you that we will never smell the sin of hell. Thank you for sending your son to die for us. We will get to rejoice with Matthew again. We love you, we trust you, and we always believe. In Jesus' name, amen.
The family has prepared some refreshments and things there in the back. So let me just close this up. Father, I thank you again for everything that you've done here tonight. I thank you for Atlanta, Lord God, the beautiful prayer that she prayed. Lord, I thank you for all of the things, Lord, that you're going to continue to do through the legacy of Matt Rotherham. And we ask, Lord God, again, that as we enjoy the evening here together, Lord, that your glory would be at the center of it, because that's exactly where Matt would want it to be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys are dismissed, please.